God is good
all the time.
Amen. Hallelujah. Well, this morning I'm starting a series of messages on the rapture of the church. I'm going to look at the congregation this morning, but I might have got my timing totally wrong because I think half of them have already gone. But now let's try as we begin. Dear Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you that your word goes out. It never returns void or empty, but it accomplishes that you purpose it to do. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you've chosen for us to live in the time period which we do. Lord, and I pray, Lord God, we would be aware of the days that we live in. Lead and guide us through this next few weeks, Lord, as we read into your word, as we look to see exactly the signs and the times that we live in. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So if you want a title for the series, it's just the end times, and today specifically is the rapture of the church. The rapture of the church. Now, there's a lot of confusion in the body of Christ when it comes to the end times. There's lots of opinions, there's lots of stuff on the internet that you see and all this sort of stuff. And I would say to anyone, stick to the word of God. Stick to the word of God, okay? Be careful what you take on board. You know, Revelation is an incredible book, and a lot of people are very fearful of the book of Revelation. They're like, oh, I'll read this, I'll read that whole Revelation, that's it, you know, that's a big bogeyman. Do you know, it is a wonderful book of encouragement. It is absolutely fantastic. And it just takes a bit of studying to really understand it. That's all it is. But it really is not that bad. So, a lot of people fall out over the book of Revelation, where we talk about the mark of the beast, final judgment, the great white throne, the great tribulation, the second advent of Jesus. There's lots of debates. And even Christians, and different theological points of view, they fall out over their point of view. Do you know what? That is playing into the hands of Satan. That's exactly what the enemy wants. Okay? Now, I've said it many times, you don't have to see eye to eye to walk hand in hand in the kingdom of God. Now, some of you will agree with this, some of you might not agree with this. Do you know what? We're the body of God together, we're the kingdom of God. Okay. So never ever, I never fall out relationally with people over scripture, because I know that is not what God wants. Even if I have an opposing point of view, do you know what? God is God, you know? And much of what we know about scripture, we get to heaven and say, oh, I didn't realise that, I didn't realise this. So let's never fall out over these things or the end time, but rather, the book of Revelation, the end time, shouldn't be something that sends the believer into fear and uncertainty. It should be something that excites us, and if we understand it, we can bring hope to people who do not understand. And that's our responsibility, to bring hope. So over the next 3 weeks, we're going to be looking at some of the future events that are outlined in the Word of God. And some of the end time signs we're going to look at as well. Now there are various views, as I said, as to the timetable. Some people believe the rapture will be before the tribulation, some people believe the rapture will be mid-tribulation, some people believe the rapture will be at the end of the tribulation. But we're going to get biblically to a completion. Nevertheless, the important point for us is to know where we stand with God today. Where are you with the Lord? Amen. It's fine to say, yes, I'm going to heaven, I'm a Christian, I'm saved, that's great. But are you in a good place with the Lord? We need to be in a good place, a healthy place. We need to have a passion for Jesus right there. And sometimes through life, through worry, through whatever, it can diminish. And we live in a very, very difficult time. We really do. We live in a difficult time with all the distractions upon us, the speed and the pace of life and the pressure. It's not an easy society to live in. Now, over the last 2,000 years, the humanity has been living in a period which I call grace. Grace. In many ways, when Jesus died on the cross and rose again, at that point, the sheep and the goat should have been divided and there should have been a final judgment, really, at that point. But because God so loved us, he has allowed a period of grace, which has been 2,000 years, for the church to be birthed, for the Gentiles to have an opportunity of salvation, up to the birth of Christ, it was just the Jews, but from the birth of Christ onward, there was an opportunity for the Gentiles, and that's us non-Jews. And God, in his grace and his love, has allowed us this 2,000-year period called grace. What are you doing with the grace God has given you in your life right now? What are you doing with it? Because it's grace that you're in. You're in a period of grace. Because the end is coming. Amen. Don't be mistaken. The end is coming. So we live in a period of grace. We've got to be thankful. We've got to use that. Some of the signs of the end times, you know, for many people, they think the end is going to be for 5,000 years or 1,000 years. Or, do you know what? Nobody knows when Jesus is coming back. The scripture says not even the Son of God himself knows. So let's not bother trying to calculate when Jesus is coming back, because even he doesn't know. Okay? But what we are called to look for is the signs of his return. Amen? And be ready. Be ready. Are you ready? If Jesus was coming back tomorrow, suddenly, or if suddenly it darkened out there, and it was the second advent of Jesus, would you sit there thinking, I need to phone somebody and put by. Oh, I need to fight with you, God. I need to repent about this. You need to do that. Okay? Whatever, when you sit in that place and that happens, that means you need to do that now. The rapture could happen tomorrow. You need to do this now. Amen? And so it's quite a good exercise sometimes to put yourself in a place, just sit where you are at some point later today and say, well, I'm going to pretend tonight is the last night of my life on earth. Not the last night of your life, because you have eternal life, but just my last night here. What do I need to say to people? And it's very challenging. So some of the end time signs that we will know will happen is a cashless society. A cashless society or a closed economic system. Do you know, every transaction made today other than with cash is traceable. They're all traceable transactions. And if you look at it, cash is going out of society fast. Do you use your card for everything, or direct debits and all these sort of things? And we're seeing a cashless society coming in. That relates to Revelation 13, verse 16. Revelation 13, 16. Now, if you've got pen and paper, you'll be taking some scriptures and you can check yourself later. Now, that talks about when the Antichrist takes control midway through the tribulation. Okay? And so, for the rapture to happen, that can happen now, at this point, we're ready. We live in the generation of the Antichrist. 1 John 2, verse 18, is an Antichrist generation. The generation that we live in now is removing Christ from society. Remember, Antichrist does not mean against Christ. That's not what it means. Antichrist doesn't mean opposed to Christ. Anti in Greek is to replace. It's instead of. So an Antichrist generation isn't a generation that is against Christ or God. It's a generation that is replacing Christ in society. We see it in schools, in colleges, in things right across the board. There's a replacement of Christ in society now. Men will become lovers of themselves. 2 Timothy 3, verse 1 to 5. We see that continually. You know, years ago, people helped each other. They lived for each other. You lived for your family. You lived for your friends. There was a community, you know. But especially in the West, we've totally lost that, and everything is about living for self, and society reinforces it. It pushes us to live for self, to look after ourselves, you know. And we've lost the whole sense of looking after one another, supporting one another, loving one another. I saw a picture a little while ago, and it was of a mum and dad with children walking down the road, and the children were like kiddiewinks, they were little, okay, walking down the road. And the parents are taking responsibility for the children, looking after them. Then it showed the same picture, this time the mum and dad were bent over and old, and the children were holding the mum and dad's hands, looking after them, making sure that they were okay and they were looked after. We don't live in that society anymore. You know, my name's Jimmy, I'll take all you can give me. You know, I put it in the can, I sit on the can, and that's it. And we live in a society where it's all about self-fulfillment, self-achievement, self-promotion. Self. And in the end times, man will become lovers of self. We have become demigods, little gods, where we now set the moral code is set by fallen man. Which is crazy. How can a fallen man with sin set a code morally for holiness? I mean, that's just beyond rationality. But yet we live in a society now where the moral code is being set by those who are fallen. And it's absolutely crazy. There will be an increase of immorality, of sin. 2 Timothy 3:13. We see that as one of the things of what I just said. False messiahs with widespread deceptions. Matthew 24:4-5. False messiahs. And you see it now. You see the gospel being preached and you say, what gospel is this? What gospel is this? There's only one gospel. It's the gospel of Jesus Christ. There's no such thing as the prosperity gospel, or this gospel, or that gospel. There's one gospel, and any other gospel is fraudulent. Many false messiahs will come with widespread deceptions. And you see that happening. There'll be wars and rumors of wars. Matthew 24:6-7. You see in that left one center, just look at Russia this week. Or what's going on? There'll be pestilence and plagues and famines in the end times. Luke 21:11. And we see that left by the centre. Fires and earthquakes and all these things. And there's a quickening in all of this. The Jews were turning back to Israel. And it says in the end times that the Lord would call his people back home. And there were Jews and flooding back to Israel, like you wouldn't believe. In actual fact, there's a movement called I Am Israel. And you can look it up online, look it up, it's called I Am Israel. And it's Jews from across the world are going back to Israel, they're being supported. And in the documentary, they show that parts of Israel, which is just barren, dead desert, and it has been for 2,000 years. And now all these Jews, especially returning from America, going to Israel, you should see the same place, you wouldn't believe it. It's lush, green, they're growing all the crops and vineyards and everything. And it's called I Am Israel, and it's to promote people to get back to living in Israel. Amazing stuff, amazing. So God has given us plenty of warnings through the relevant signs, and we can be here all day just talking about them. But these signs should not be fearful for us, but they should stir our hope. The King is coming. Matthew 24:1. Jesus left the temple and was talking and was walking away when his disciples came to him and called his attention to his buildings. Do you see all these things? He asked. Truly I tell you, not one stone here will be left upon another. Every stone will be thrown down. And he was talking about the physical temple. And we're now 70 years after that. The Romans invaded Israel completely, and they destroyed the temple, and not one stone was left upon another. And do you know why that was? Because they burned Israel, and the temple had gold in the temple, on the outside of the temple, and the fire was so intense that gold melted down the bricks, down the columns, and went in between the bricks. So for the Roman soldiers to get their wages, they got it through what they pillaged, what they stole. So that to get the gold, they had to take one brick off of another and scrape each brick to get the gold out. Wow. Only our God. Amazing. Matthew 24, verse 3. Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives, and his disciples came to him privately. Tell us, they said, when will these things happen? And what will be the sign of your coming at the end of the age? Jesus answered, watch out that no one deceives you. First protocol. Put your thinking caps on. Stop running mad and following every latest fashion in the kingdom of God and the world. He said, first of all, watch out that no one deceives you. How are you protected against deception? Because scripture says even the elect, which is us, can be deceived. So you've got to look and you've got to think about it. You've got to say, how am I protected? You know? I know many people have changed their persuasion on scripture, like the weather. How are you protected? How are you protecting yourself to know what I believe? Is it the right? Is it mine? And that comes through wise counsel. Safety in wise counsel. For many will come in my name, claiming I am the Messiah, and will deceive many. You will hear the wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you are not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end will still come. Nation will rise up against nation, kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of birth pains. So this is the beginning. It's not the tribulation in full. It says when this is happening, you're at the beginning. You're at the end of the next page. The page is going to turn, and that's where you're at. So we have to be clear. We have to be a peace in our heart. And sometimes the church does a funny thing. It plays against all those things. That's what the church does. It turns out, oh, we've got to pray for peace everywhere. We've got to pray that we don't have a cashless society. We've got to pray against this and against that. And you're praying against what God has said is going to happen. Okay? So what you need to do is change the way we pray and say, Lord, I pray for your will in this situation. What's your will in Russia? Now, I know God's will is that people come to Him. I know God's will is that even in a bad situation, people will lean on Jesus. That, you know, that's how you pray God's will. Sometimes they say, well, I don't know what God's will is for Russia. Is it Crimea? Or is it wherever it is? Is it Russia? Is it, do you know what? It's simple. You pray for the will of God. And the will of God is that all men will come to know Jesus Christ. Amen. So sometimes the church is praying against the very things that Father said was going to happen. And we're praying against them. But rather instead of praying against them, we should be praying for one another and our families and our loved ones. That's what we've got to be praying for. Amen? These signs are more evident in our generation than any other. Since World War II, there have been 285 conflicts with millions dying. Wow. Luke 21, verse 11. There will be great earthquakes and famine, pestilence in various places, and fearful events with great signs from the heavens. So there will be fear. It will be frightening. You know? It's going to be awful. I mean, I find it, as I'm sure you must, as Christians, find it quite difficult to live in the society we live in. It's so self-centered. It's so uncaring. It's lost his compassion, the compassion of God, it's just become polluted. And it's really difficult. I don't fit in this jigsaw puzzle called Earth. I just don't fit in it. It doesn't do it for me anymore. I struggle when I watch the news and I see society. And the Lord says, that's because you're not of this. You're in the world, but you are not of this. And for the believer, we struggle, we find it difficult. Big earthquakes have doubled in 2014, each year in comparison with 1979. In January 2020, there were around 5,139 earthquakes happening per month. That is an increase which is over 50%. We've also seen an increase of various diseases and illnesses over the last century. Even COVID now, you know? And then you deal with one part of COVID, it just mutilates and it becomes another part of COVID. And you deal with that part of COVID, it mutilates and becomes another part of COVID. And what's worse, some of these diseases in the end times will be man-made. They're not even natural diseases. This is the war and the attempt of Satan attacking society. It's not even natural causes in some of these things. Matthew 24:24, false messiahs and false prophets will appear, performing great signs and wonders to deceive, if it were possible, even the elect. I mean, even in the churches now, you look at the prophets and everything else. Did you see on TV, probably about 2 years ago, I might say that a very world-famous American preacher, prophet, and he stood up and said, COVID is gone, I'll blow it away. In the name of Jesus, there's no more COVID. Finished! It's gone, it's gone, it's gone! I don't think so, mate. I don't know what you're doing, but COVID is very much still here. There are so many false prophets. How many prophets out there prophesying, and if you test the prophecies, it has not come to pass. It hasn't happened. And in the church, which is awful, people are running mad wanting to go to prophecy meetings because they want the word of knowledge. And do you know what it is? It is fortune telling in the church. Oh, I want to know whether I should buy this thing or that thing. I want to know if I'll have a new relationship by the end of the year. You go to a meeting, Lord, pick me, let it be me. You're like, oh my God, I want to read the lottery. It's you. You know? And we're just waiting for a word of the Lord because you want to know your future. That's what it is you want to know. It's fortune telling. It's dangerous. Of the enemy, and the so-called prophets running around prophesying in church, and in church meetings, if you believe, do you see the prophets stand up, prophesying to someone? 90% of the time, never happened. Come on, be real. It did not. Nonsense in the body of Christ. And even in the end times, in the church, we've got so many false prophets, and what it does, it knocks people off of their dependency on Jesus Christ. And worry, and their own walk with Jesus. It's a lamp unto the feet, not a floodlight unto your future. It's a lamp unto your feet. And you've got, yes, there is genuine prophecy, of course. I've prophesied over people, and I've had prophecy over me. But I'll still test it, because that's what Scripture says. Matthew 24:37. As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man, as it was in the days of Noah. So if you want to liken a time frame to look for a sign, you've got to look and say, well, as it was in the days of Noah, that's what it would be like in the end time. But what was it like in the days of Noah then? Genesis 6:11-12. Now the earth was corrupt. She hasn't even got to say anymore. Now the earth was corrupt. Is the earth corrupt? Yes, look at the corruption. It in his world today. Even Daddy's dream. I don't know if they have a party or karaoke night or anything else to live for. I mean, there's corruption left, right and centre. Corruption in everything. People are corrupt. Corruption in the church. Corruption in all these businesses. Corruption, corruption, corruption. And you see it left, right and centre. Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight. Now if the earth is corrupt in my sight, how much more God's sight? You know, Isaiah said, I'm a man of unclean lips and I live with people of unclean lips. And now how can I compare with your glory or come into your presence? Because if we as humans see the corruption, how much more God? Now the earth was corrupt in God's sight. And it was filled with violence. And God saw the earth, and behold, it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. And we see it now. We're legalizing around the world euthanasia. Just injecting old people. Granddad's old enough now, dad enough, let's just put him down like a dog. In actual fact, let's put him down at the vets, it's cheaper. You know? We abort billions of children being aborted. Let's use the real word, murdered, slaughtered, never got the opportunity for a breath. And do you know what? Society doesn't think twice about it, what? It's alright. Isn't that okay? People don't care whether my body is my body. See, men become lovers of themselves. It's my body, it's my right, you know? And we have to be very careful. And I understand sometimes the reason behind things. I'm full of compassion. I understand sometimes the reason why people do things, but it doesn't make it right. And it's not right. We need to stand up and be counted sometimes. In the days of Noah, the whole world had become enslaved to sin and wickedness. They hated what was good and they loved what was evil. And only Noah and his family remained godly and survived God's judgment. Are we like the days of Noah now? When you look at society, look at all what's going on, the way men have become. 2 Timothy 3, verse 1. But mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not lovers of the good, treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power, having nothing to do with such people. Wow, isn't that amazing? Can't we just see society in this? People will be lovers of themselves. Well, before anybody, people love themselves. They think, what's best for me? What's the best decision for me? It's my life. My life. So I've got to decide what's best for me. And I'm going to make the best decision for me, and that's it. You know, and it's the complete opposite to kingdom living. Kingdom living, when you become a Christian, you lay down your rights at the cross. You say, I lay down my rights, I'm not going to do what's best for me. I'm going to live according to your will, and I want your best before my best. And if your best cancels my best, so be it. I want you to buy that thing you really like. You know? But it's true. We love ourselves. We're lovers of money. We're always pushing for more. You know? All of us who are at work. Do you know? If your boss comes in and says, right, who wants the pay rise? Who wants to get to man up? We all want a pay rise. We're not content. We want more. Enough is never enough. And you will always live to the limit of your income. Trust me, I know. I know I've done it in the past, so the time we're flat, quite everything, we're living on jelly to survive, and it was just really, really bad. A few years later, we're like, well, we've got double the income that we used to have, but we're still broke. Yeah, but no, we're not living on jelly anymore, we just have stayed in the glass of wine. You know what I mean? Could you end up living to your income stream? You know? But that's why it's difficult to give money to things, to give money to the kingdom of God. Bring your first fruits, the first fruits should be coming into the kingdom of God. We don't do that. Give my first fruits into the kingdom of God when I've worked out my budget. I'm just saying it the way it is. Boastful, look at Facebook, TikTok, and Instagram. Everyone puts up their greatest stuff. They don't put their bad ones up, of course not, but their greatest stuff. Just look at Wikis. But they do, everyone puts up the stuff they're proud of. All this different stuff. Children were very disobedient to their parents. You see, the way some children talk to their parents, if I had done that, I would have been the first man with the ability to fly. Because my mum and dad would have knocked me into the next week if I dared speak to them the way some children speak to their parents. And the parents go, oh, you didn't want to be moved, come on. What is what? The way they speak to them, have you no fear of God? Without that unforgiving, you see unforgiveness in the body of Christ, let alone the unsaved. People are so, they find it so hard to forgive. People get offended so easily. Easily offended. Oh, I'm upset about that, I'm upset about this, I'm upset about that. Half the time they don't even know why they're upset. They're just upset, they're just offended. You know, and people are so offensive these days and sensitive. And, you know, trying to love some people is like trying to cuddle a cactus. You know? It's nice and soft in the middle, but the outside you're prickling, you know? And then they wonder why nobody wants to give them a hug. Well, you look like a bulldog stuck in a wasp. They'll give you a hug, I don't even want to say hello to you, you look so miserable. And people, they put out that vibe, don't even try and be nice to me. Don't even try and come. Don't even try and smile at me. And you go to that area. Oh, hello. Just society and the way it's become. Without self-control, slanderous, cancel culture. Cancel everybody out. Somebody said 4 years ago, this, that and the other. What? Delete them out of society. 25 years ago, this person said X, Y and Z. What? Delete them, cancel them, destroy their career, destroy their reputation, destroy their family, destroy everything they've ever built for, spit on them and walk off. That's the society we live in. Treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than the lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power. What does it mean to have a form of godliness but deny its power? It means to have the principle, to have the wording of godliness, but you deny the power which is the love. They can talk the scripture, but they can't show you the love. They can tell you the scripture of forgiveness, but they can't forgive you because they deny the power of Christ Jesus. You know, people can quote scripture, it doesn't mean to say they live in it. And there's a lot of people that have a form of godliness about them. They know the scripture, they know this, that, and the other, but they deny its power to forgive, to be caring, to be loving, to be grateful, to be generous. Daniel chapter 12, verse 4. But you, Daniel, roll up and seal the words of the scroll until the time of the end. Many will go here and there to increase knowledge. If you look at the increase of knowledge, it is phenomenal. I said this before. It's only just over 100 years ago that there wasn't even a car. Just over 100 years ago, everyone was still going around on a horse. A horse was the quickest form of transport about 130 years ago. A horse. Now, you can get to Australia in a day. You can send an email now to Australia and bam, it's by now. But for me, that's still too long. You know, talk about fast food. You know, we want it yesterday. You queue up at McDonald's, if they haven't got it out within a minute, you're like, well, this isn't really good service. Not very impressed with this. Don't think I'll come back here again. Go home, cook your own dinner, you lazy. No, but we get no patience. And the speed at which knowledge, the explosion of knowledge, the internet, the way we work digitally now, the explosion of knowledge is vast. It is exploding and exploding and exploding and exploding like an unprecedented rate. It is phenomenal where we will be in the next 5 years. Phenomenal. Anything you buy electronically, the day you bought it is out of date. The day you bought it is out of date. They've already got the next model, two or three versions up, probably already mapped out. So what you think you think is, oh, I've got the latest one, it's actually old fashioned. Right? And that's a kick in the teeth for men like Mike or me who love our technology. They're sitting there like a normal schoolwork, but yeah, technology. But it's true, the explosion of knowledge over the last 150 years is unbelievable. We look at scientific discoveries, the stars, I mean, they're always doing it. The moon, every time they send out a new satellite, they say, oh, we got it wrong. We can see 10 times more than we thought. They send another one out, oh, we got it wrong. We can see 20 times more than we thought. Why don't you stick to the word of God? God said, they're innumerable. You cannot count them. Just accept it. Save your money on your satellites. Okay? DNA. All of that sort of stuff is just phenomenal. Social media, contactless cars, virtual reality, driverless cars, all sorts of things. Humans are living at such a fast rate that the knowledge they're seeking left, right and centre. And even Christians doing it for biblical knowledge, running after signs and wonders. Oh, there, gold dust appearing in the church. Quick, everybody in the car, let's go there. I'll be honest with you, I won't be going to see the Rapture of the Sun, just give me to God. I'll be taking that straight down to Cashmere and Vicky and couple of new watches. Yeah. You know? But people see a sign and they chase after it. Oh, God is appearing here and he's manifesting in that church. Let's go there. Oh, no, he's appearing here. Go to that conference. Oh, no, he's... And people are rushing all over. It's a crazy society. So when it comes to the rapture of the church then, in this end time period, what is the rapture of the church and why? Why is there a rapture of the church? What is it and why is it? The word rapture doesn't appear in the Bible. Well, not in the Hebrew or the Greek, it does appear in the Latin. But the word rapture doesn't appear in the Bible, but the event appears in the Bible several times, but the word rapture doesn't. And some will say, well, if the word doesn't appear in the Bible, I don't believe in the event. Well, the word Trinity does not appear in the Bible, anywhere in Scripture. But the event appears, we believe in God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit. We believe in the Trinity and what it represents. So what is the rapture all about then? If we're living in these end times, we've got to be aware. So what is the rapture all about? The word rapture is a Latin word that comes from rapio, which means caught up or snatched away. So the rapture is going to be something where you're caught up quickly or you're snatched away. Okay? It's not going to be something where you start thinking, oh, no, all the rapture's going to happen, I must pack my bag, I must take my time, I must make... It's just going to happen. It's not going to be like going on holiday to Greece. Okay? Not going to be able to read the brochure and prepare to get the sun cream and your insurance. When the rapture happens, it will happen with the twinkling of an eye. So it means we will be caught up. It refers to a prophetic event which Jesus will call the church, his body, born again believer, into the heavenlies, and the church will be caught up so that all Christians, born again, genuine believer, Jesus will come down from heaven and he will call us up to meet with him in the sky. Let's turn to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 8. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13, sorry. We do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death. Sleep in death, not dead, sleep in death. Hallelujah. So that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. Because we have a hope and we have a joy. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again. And so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. That is Christians who have died since Pentecost, whether it was Pentecost 2,000 years ago or last Friday, according to the Lord's word. We tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. So the Lord himself will come down from heaven with the trump call of God. Now all of human history moves forward by a trumpet call in heaven. Okay? So the next phase of history is going to happen, and there's a trumpet call, and all of heaven knows the phase of history that is about to happen, that they're going into. And it says, with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up or raptured. We will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So the rapture of the church is an event that will happen in the end times. The dead in Christ will rise first, and then the believers who are alive will be changed and we will meet Jesus in the air. And so we will ever be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Wonderful, brilliant. Encourage one another with these words. Don't say be frightened of them and never read about it. It says encourage one another. We could be called up with the Lord in the air. You're sitting there looking at the pile of iron in the bosh. Wonderful. Brilliant. Stop the iron. You don't need to worry about sitting there with a big report to do right there. Bosh. You're with the Lord. Wonderful. Isn't it wonderful? Just about to have to pay one of your debts and bosh. You've gone along with the money. You're called up in the air, the person goes, where are you gone? Where are you gone? And do you know what? The reply, the response to the world as to what has happened will be given probably by the Antichrist. The Antichrist will give the reason for this phenomenon. Most likely. That's my opinion. Most likely. So what Paul is saying is that when a believer dies, his or her soul goes immediately into the presence of the Lord in heaven. But one day, without any warning or any sign, God will bring Jesus and the souls of the believers, the members of the church who have died since Pentecost, to meet with him in the air, and they will be given their new bodies. Amen? Their new bodies, the molecules of their bodies, whether they were buried or cremated, their molecules will come together and they will be given new bodies. You're going to get a new body. Wonderful. You know, now, unfortunately, he doesn't do requests. What? I'll talk to the husbands. Behave yourself. But you're going to have a new body. And it's going to be a glorious body. A transformed body. A body that will never seem decay. Not one grey hair will come out of your eyebrows. Because that's where mine are coming at the moment. In the eyebrows. Everywhere. Yeah, Stephen, just be happy to answer that. You know? But you're going to have a new body. And it's going to work fantastically. Just as you would world. And it's going to be glorious. It will never age, it will never decay, it will never experience pain or sin or disease. It will be wonderful. Then the church on the earth, all the Christians who are still alive, will be taken up to meet Jesus in the air in their new resurrected bodies, to meet with Jesus and join the believers who have already got their resurrected bodies. And Jesus will take us into heaven. Amen? So we're going to meet with Jesus in the air, all the dead in Christ will rise, and then Jesus will say, what? Now we're going into heaven. You'll find out the reason why in a minute. So the rapture of the church is simply the removal of the church. It is not the second coming. It is not the judgment. It is the removal of the believers to meet with Jesus in the air. Now, there are things that need to take place around the world for the second coming of Jesus to happen. Biblical things that need to take place. There is nothing that needs to take place for the rapture of the church to happen. Everything, every sign is in place for it to happen now. Okay, I want you to understand that. But there are things that need to happen for the second advent of Jesus Christ to take place. Armageddon. Okay, we're going to talk about that in a few weeks. Paul explaining the same event in 1 Corinthians 15:51. Listen, I tell you a mystery. Now, one thing you've got to understand in reading your Bible, the church is a complete mystery. The church isn't mentioned in the Old Testament. The church is a mystery. The Old Testament was for the Jews. And the church is a mystery. And Paul says, listen, I tell you a mystery. A mystery is something unknown. I tell you a mystery. We will not all sleep, but we will be changed in a flash, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. Remember, the trumpet sounds that move the phases of history. At the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound, and the dead in Christ will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. Hallelujah. Isn't it wonderful? It excites me. I think it's absolutely fantastic. Exciting. I can't wait. Hallelujah. Sorry. In a flash, in the twinkling of an eye. Wow. I should start practicing with Mama. See if she gets ready quicker. You know, I say, you ready, love? Yeah, I'm coming now. I could sit in the car for 15 minutes before that now is complete. Honestly, she's one of them people. Cooking dinner, she'll shout out, dinner's ready! And us boys get together, we get that, and you wait for half an hour before you eat anything. I said, when I cook, not that I'm any better, but when I cook, and I shout out to the boys, I say, guys, dinner's on the table. It's not blasphemous, it's not a lie. The dinner is on the table! Amen? It's there! When Mama said, guys, dinner's on the table, dinner's ready! Another 20 minutes or so, good George, you're getting back. Bless her heart, she's not here, I'll get points. Do it be changed in the flash and the twinkling of an eye? Do you know what Mama would say about that? She might say, oh, well, hang on a minute, I've got me bits together yet. She went, that's my 30 bits. Paul says the church is a mystery, it's unrevealed. Ephesians 5:32. This is a profound mystery, but I am talking about Christ and the church. And that a lot of people don't understand the relationship between Christ and the church, even believers. You are the bride of Christ. You are not just a person who believes in a faith. You are not just a person who believes in a philosophy or a way of life. You have been transformed by the Holy Spirit at salvation. And at that point, you became the bride of Christ. You became a son or daughter of God. You became accepted into the family of God. You became a person of authority in the spiritual realm. a new identity. Okay? So you've got to look at what your relationship is with God to fully understand. So Paul said we're being transformed in the flash, twinkling of an eye. That's quicker than any point of time that you can imagine. Now we will be removed. So why has the rapture got to take place? So if we're saying the rapture comes first, then a 7-year period called the tribulation, or should I say great tribulation, okay? Which is a 7-year period. 3.5 years, and then another 3.5 years. The first 3.5 years of the tribulation will be bad. The second 3.5 years will be the worst thing that the world has ever seen. Making up 7 years. John the Baptist preached for 3.5 years, grace. Jesus preached the greatest grace of all for the second 3.5 years, 7 years. This next event is broken into 2 3.5 year periods, and at the end of those 7 years, Jesus Christ will return. So if the rapture of the church is going to happen first, what is the 7-year period on earth about? We know, because the earth is going to come under judgment. It is a time of spiritual warfare, when God moves and begins to judge the earth. 7-year period and the reign of Antichrist and the false prophets. Okay? What will we be doing then for the 7 years if the rapture has to happen first? Why can't the rapture be at the end and we go straight up, meet with Jesus, and coming down anyway to judge the earth, and we just meet them in the sky, come down? Well, that can't happen. Because there's something what's got to take place. Okay? In Jewish culture, when a wedding took place, the bridegroom went to the bride's house and he collected the bride. Now, there had been a pre-arranged agreement in the culture, a dowry had been paid, an agreement had taken place that this person is going to be married to that person. Okay? The wedding ceremonies we have today, we stand there and we join people together in holy matrimony and we go through promises, that did not exist in the times of Jesus. The wedding ceremony itself was the removal of the bride from her father's house. That's it, we're married. They say we're packing again. That's it, we're married. That was the marriage ceremony. Deposit had already been made, agreement had been made. The bridegroom comes along, he picks up his bride, and they are now married. And then they carry on and they go directly to the reception and the celebration. We are the bride of Christ, and Jesus is coming back for his bride. And what he's going to do, he's just going to collect us, and that's it. We're married in that relationship to the Lord. And that is what we'll be doing at the rapture. He will come back to collect his bride and he will take his bride into heaven. While some believe that the rapture will be in the tribulation, midpoint, or after the tribulation, this does not sit with this reality. Thessalonians 2 verse 7. So the secret power of lawlessness is already at work. But the one who holds it back will continue to do so till he is taken out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will overthrow by the breath of his mouth and destroy it by the splendour of his coming. Now this is a very important scripture to understand a couple of points. For the secret power of lawlessness is already at work, which is the demonic realm, evil. It's already at work around the world, we know it. But the one who holds it back will continue to do so until he is taken out of the way. So there's a personality or a person that is restraining evilness and restraining lawlessness around the globe, around the entire earth. And it's being restrained. In other words, it's not manifest as it could be because it's being restrained. And it's being restrained by a person, and it will remain restrained until he is taken out of the way. Who is that person? That is the Holy Spirit. How will he be taken out of the way? Because he lives in the lives of the believer. And when the church is called up in the rapture, so the Holy Spirit in the lives of the believers will be removed from the face of the earth. Now, because God is omnipresent, the Holy Spirit will still be present, but not in the form that he was. It will be more like in the Old Testament, where he came down to interject and then left. And the ministry is different. He does not reside. So when the Holy Spirit goes, it says, then the lawless one will be revealed. So why is everyone trying to work out who the Antichrist is? Why is the church trying to work out who the Antichrist is? There's no point. It says, until he is taken out of the way, then the lawless one will be revealed. If you are still here and he's been taken out of the way, you're in trouble. Because it means you weren't a Christian. You didn't receive salvation. You were full of religion. You were full of something, but it weren't Christ. And there'd be many people in that time when the rapture happens, the penny will drop and say, but I went to church. But I did this. But I did the other. But you didn't. You weren't transformed. You didn't love God. In reality, be honest. You did it. You went to church because you felt obliged. You gave because you felt guilty. You wanted to have a good conscience, whatever it was. You wanted to look good in stuff. Well, I went because my mum and dad went, or I went because of this, that, and the other, or so on and so forth. And it's going to be an awful time for those people. They're going to stand there horrified. But God's grace is they can still get saved. There are other people, non-Christians, I sat with, and I went on doing this with them, because they don't want to believe in Jesus. I said, well, let me bore you with this instead. Because when you see this happen, you remember what I said to you. You get on your knees and you pray. Jude 14, verse 15. Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about them. See, the Lord is coming with thousands upon thousands of his holy ones. That's you. Amen. You're there. That's you. If you've ever felt unimportant or ever wanted a big part to play in life, that's you right there. Okay, that's me. I'm one of these thousands of his holy ones. To judge everyone and to convict them all of sin and the ungodly acts that they have committed in their ungodliness and all their defiant words and ungodly sinners have spoken against him. Wow. 1 Thessalonians 1:9. They tell how you turn to God from idols to serve the living and true God and wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the coming wrath. Hallelujah. You're not going to face the tribulation. Yes, you will face tribulation soon. Because we all face tribulations. There are many tribulations we face. But you will not face the coming wrath, the tribulation. Why? Because you can't. Why can't you? Because the great tribulation is a time of judgment. And you are exempt from judgment. Why? Because you have already been judged at the cross of Calvary. You were judged and you were found guilty as charged. And Jesus said, for all those who accept me, I will take their place. I will take the punishment. And Jesus has been judged on your behalf. So the tribulation, the 7-year period, is a time. time of judgment on the earth, that God is judging the earth, and you can't be judged. Why? Because you've been judged. Hallelujah. Isn't it wonderful? I'd rather have the judgment of grace than the judgment of wrath. Because the time is coming like the world has never known. But you can't be judged. Could you be judged? You've been judged. You've already been judged. 1 Thessalonians 5:9. For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through the Lord Jesus Christ. He died for us so that we, whether awake or asleep, we may live together with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. Wonderful. If the church is going to go through a time of tribulation, the great tribulation, 7-year period, which is a time of judgment, and then be raptured at the end, it doesn't come into line with scripture of things what would take place. If the church can go through the tribulation, then it's tantamount to the cross of Jesus, the very fact that we've already been judged. And there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Romans 8 verse 1. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Because through Christ, the law of the Spirit, who gives life, has set you apart and freed you from the law of sin and death. Hallelujah. Wonderful. Once the rapture takes place, we will appear before, apart from our marriage to Jesus, something else has got to take place in the 7-year period in the heavenly, and that is the Bema seat of Christ, the judgment seat of Christ. Now, we are the Bema seat of Christ and judgment seat of Christ is not judgment of sin. Sin has been judged 2,000 years ago. It is a judgment of works. Wood, straw, hay, stubble, gold. What are your words? What was your motive in what you did? Did you really love the Lord? Did you try to honor him? And all of our works will be judged by Jesus himself. And some will be of straw and hay, some will be of gold and silver, mud huts and palaces, and we will be rewarded for our works on the earth. And so all of the church has got to go through a time of judgment in heaven. But there's no condemnation. So don't sit there thinking, oh, I'll be bad. There's no condemnation. So how is it going to work? I don't know. Quite honestly, I've not got the foggiest idea. Okay? But our works will be judged. And yet we will be without condemnation. Our works will be judged while we're in heaven in the 7-year period. The marriage of the Lamb will take place and we will be joined in with Christ in celebration. Revelation 1-5 is written about the church. It is about the church. When you read it, Revelation chapter 1 up to chapter 5. Revelation chapter 6 to chapter 19 covers a 7-year period known as the Great Tribulation. And what is interesting is Revelation 2 verse 7 and Revelation 3 verse 6 says, whoever has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, what the Holy Spirit says to the churches. That's in Revelation 2 and in Revelation 3. And it says, whoever has an ear, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. But in Revelation 13, verse 9, which is halfway through the tribulation, it says, whoever has an ear, let them hear. Let them hear. Whoever has an ear, let them hear. It's not addressed to the church anymore, because the church ain't there. The church is in heaven. It's in glory. Amen? It just says, whoever has an ear, let them hear. And it doesn't even say what the Spirit says to the churches. The church is not mentioned, but we're with the Lord in glory. To understand said in Scripture, we can see the perfect love of God through his people at work. His perfect love casts out all fear, for fear has to do with punishment. But you can't be punished, because you've been punished in Christ. So you can't, you can be disciplined, you can be trained, but you can't be punished. Amen? Because your punishment had already been applied. We can thank God for his love and his grace displayed through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Because of Christ's suffering, we do not have an appointment with fear, we do not have an appointment with punishment, rather we have a quickening in our hearts to meet the Lord in our new resurrection bodies. We can serve his purposes without sin and decay and failure in the future. Through the rapture of the church, in its timing, it will trigger the worst period of human history called the Great Tribulation. For the church, the rapture will be a glorious day. It will probably happen in our lifetime. It may not happen for another 5,000 years, but it will most likely happen in our lifetime. Wow. We can face tomorrow, we can face the end times, and we can face what's happening in Russia and the Ukraine and different things happening around the world and even at number 10 parties. We can face things without fear and tribulation because we are comforted by the Holy Spirit. God is in control of all things. He is sovereign. It is his timetable, not Satan's. Bear that in mind. Sometimes you can feel the earth running out of control and Satan is in charge. No. It's his timetable. The Lord's timetable. So with that, I encourage you to be encouraged. Read your word. Be ready. Give people an answer for the hope that you have in your heart. Amen? Amen. Next Sunday, we're going to be looking at the events and the personalities in the Great Tribulation. The following Sunday, if we're still here, we'll be looking at the second coming of Jesus himself and that glorious day Armageddon. Amen? Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for your word, Lord. I pray that in some way we might have done some form of justice this morning as we try to read and uncover, Lord, your timing and your plan. Father, I pray that each one of us will be so ready for the rapture of the church, Lord. We will be ready mentally, emotionally, spiritually. We will be ready in our relationship with other people. Lord, I pray that we would not have to panic and suddenly try and get things right to be secure in you. We can know that because of the shed blood of Jesus, you have bought us and we love you and we're secure. Thank you for your forgiveness for sin, Lord God. Thank you for cleansing us. And thank you, Lord, for the days that we live. May we be different in our generation. For the knowledge that we have is just incredible. Holy Spirit, lead us and guide us through this next week. We pray your blessing over the congregation, Lord, in every way. We pray, Lord, for Wednesday that we pray and fast, Lord God, that we can come together in prayer in the evening, Lord, as pulse groups of the church. We glory in your goodness, in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Amen.